is the wisdom, if you have wisdom, duh, then obviously you're going to make good choices when it comes to temptation. You know, I love, Mandy, what you're saying, that you're celebrating the victories as well. You know, the enemy wants you to dwell on the fact that you failed, that you fell into temptation, that you, because he loves it, you know, he wants to get us away from the good things. You know, in the book of James, at the end of chapter 2, it talks about temptation, and it says that the enemy, he pulls you away. I'm going to read this to you, because this is great. This is in James chapter 2. I see, well, it might be chapter 1. Let me see. James chapter, it's chapter 1, and it's verse 13. It says, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when, by his own desire, our flesh, and I also believe the enemy, okay, is dragged away and enticed. Then, after desire has been conceived, the act, the deception, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's full blown, gives birth to death. And that goes back to that other verse. I don't know your name again. All I see is iPad 5BG, GR, whatever Z. But the verse,
That's Patricia.
Patricia, you had said that verse 27 and 7 said her highway is a highway to the grave, leading down to the chambers of death. So what's interesting about temptation is the temptation itself is not a sin. And like Gina says, we're going to go through life, we're tempted. This is a broken, messed up world run by the enemy. And his goal 24/7 is to destroy you. He wants to destroy your joy. He wants to destroy your love. He wants to destroy your family. He wants to destroy your health, your finances. He wants you fat, disgusting. He wants you broke. He wants you to have no relationships with your family. He doesn't want you to go to church. He wants you to worry. He wants you to stress. He wants you to stay angry. So how does he go about getting you into those places? Well, what's interesting is, do you remember when Jesus was tempted by the devil? We all know that story, right? He takes him into the wilderness, into the desert, and he tempts him. And I think what's neat about this story, ladies, is that first of all, the devil had the gall to tempt Jesus, the Son of God. Okay, so if he's going to tempt Jesus, he's going to tempt you. Okay. And what's even more crazy is he not only tempts him with the flesh, with power, with the fact that he could throw himself and kill himself and the angels will take care of him, all the things that he does with us, he tempts us with food, he tempts us with comfort, he tempts us with power. We love to be in control. Right now in COVID, we're not in control, right? We're not in control and we don't like it. Now, some of you are on all different parts of the scale, but when somebody threatens your money, somebody threatens your safety, somebody threatens your kids, somebody threatens your job, you don't like it. And so the enemy tempted Jesus with power. So what does he do to us? He knows the places he thinks he can pull you away. That's what he did with Jesus. He tried to pull him away from his safety, from the things that he felt would give him a better chance to get him. And what's interesting at the end, it's in one of the gospels. I was trying to find it while Gina was sharing, is that he said at the end, when Jesus told him, you know, that you're not going to get me, dude. You know what? I will serve no other God but the God. He says, that's okay. And he said, I'll come back another time. I'm like, what? You come back another, wait a minute. You just know who he is. He's already said what's going to happen to you, right? And yet the devil didn't give up, which tells us, and it goes back to what Gina was saying, you got to know the word, ladies. You got to know the word so good that you can speak it back at him. When he tries to tear you down, when he tells you you're nothing, when he tells you you're single, you'll never be married, or that your marriage won't work out, or your kids are going to be this, or you're never going to get a job, or COVID's going to last forever. When he tells you all this, and you have to combat it with the truth. You're right. I don't know about COVID. I don't know what's going to happen, but he does. The word says, give us this day, not our week, not our month, not our season. Give us this day. God wants us to be in the day. He's been trying to get us in the day since the day we were born, but we keep getting ahead of him because we like to plan. And understand, there's nothing wrong with planning. There's nothing wrong with being a Martha some days. We all need to be Martha. If it weren't for Martha, we never eat, right? But there has to be that balance. There has to be that place in our life to where we go, Lord, I will make some plans because plans are okay. I'm sure Jesus planned his disciples. He planned when he went to get them and called them. He planned that we would go to this city and we'd go to that city, okay? There's nothing wrong with planning. But understand, too, there are things that distract that plan that are in this world because we are in this world, but we are not of this world. And there are things that will pull us away and entice us. And for some of us, it is chocolate. And some of us is coffee. A lot of it. Too much. And some of it's certain TV shows. Certain books. Some people read all those romance books. Lord have mercy. I wonder in the Hallmark movies, I wonder if the guy's going to get the girl. I mean, like, it's the same story. Every single time you watch a Hallmark movie, there's always a dog, a really good-looking guy that just happens to be single. I'm just telling you, at my age, there aren't hardly any good-looking men left, you know? And so that's just so unrealistic, but we watch them. And all it does is it pulls you into this world, this fantasy world that maybe he's out there, or maybe my husband will become like that guy. Maybe I'll leave. Maybe he'll watch it with me and become romantic, you know? Or maybe it's you go to Walmart and you can't help but spend $100 every time you're in Walmart. You try, but you know what? This is what I do in Walmart to help me with temptation. I used to go in there. Well, first of all, I wouldn't be able to find a parking spot. And I always said, God, if I'm not supposed to go to Walmart today, don't let me find a parking spot. But then I just drive around till I found one. Then once I get in, I would see this and, oh, I need those jeans. I need that shirt. I need that gadget. I love that row that says, as seen on TV. You know that row? I got the peg egg to get rid of the calluses on your feet. That's good. That's a good product. But the jeans, the pajama jeans, one size fits some. It don't even fit some. Do not buy them. Pajama jeans do not look good unless you're a stick, okay? So I would buy this stuff, and then I would be worried about my finances like Diane. And I'd come home, or the Dollar Tree was another place. I'd find, oh, well, it's only a dollar, and I'd find myself spending $30, $40, $50 on junk. And then God said to me, Chris, I want you to pray before you put in, I want you to pray about everything in your buggy. And then I'd get the end of my shopping trip. And I'm like, man, I got to put it all back. I could just abandon the buggy, but that wouldn't be a Christ-like. That means I got to put it all back. And I don't even know where it all goes. And it requires exercise. And I don't really want to exercise today because that's another area I struggle in. And so then God says, well, why don't you do this next time. I want you to pray about it before you put it in the buggy. And here's the thing. If I want you to have those jeans, if I want you to have that knickknack, if I want you to have the bananas or whatever it is, I will put it on your heart and I will give you permission and you will get a peace. Because the reason why you get a peace, Chris, is because you've stayed in fellowship with me. You stayed connected to the vine. You've asked my guidance. You've sought my wisdom. So then now I can make a decision that is by you. But when I leave him outside of my decision and the enemy pulls me into the chip aisle, to the cookie aisle, he pulls me into the ice cream aisle, right? He pulls me into something I know I don't need. And that's when my brain leaves my head. There's no accountability. There's nobody there. I mean, even if there was, you think I'm going to call one of my godly Christian friends and say, hey, I'm in the cookie aisle. You better come get me now, right? No, I'm in the cookie aisle. I'm going to give me some cookies, right? And so that goes back to, again, what Gina was saying. We have to have accountability. We have to have the people in our life that know the areas we struggle with. So I don't go to buffets, and now, praise God, they're probably done away with, you know? And if you know that it's an area of struggle, then God's not saying you can't have something at Walmart. God's not saying you can't have chocolate, or that you can't watch a Hallmark movie. But if these things pull you out of fellowship, if you find that these things begin to make you think of not of God, if this robs you of your time with God, if it robs you of your time with family, if the things that pull you away are creating anger between you and someone else, creating issues with your family, from your finances and not being able to pay the bills, to even your fellowship with Jesus. If you're finding that you're being pulled away, because I'm going to tell you guys, it's really hard to sit there and eat a bunch of stuff that you know is not good for you, or watch a TV show that is of the enemy, and sit there and talk to Jesus at the same time. The word says you can't do both. You have to pick one or the other. So the final thing to just share is John 10:10 is my life verse. I love John 10:10. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and I've come to give life. I love this verse because it reminds me that the enemy's goal is to kill me. I've been on this weight loss journey for quite a long time. Gina knows about this. I used to weigh about 130 pounds more, and I am not a spokesman. I'm not a poster child. It is a daily journey. It is an hourly journey. Everything I put in my mouth, I have to pray about and choose. And it is very difficult because I love sugar. Sugar is a drug. And for me, it's a horrible drug. It is so addicting. And I cannot allow food become a punishment. God is not punishing me by taking away food. He is giving me life by having me choose good food. But I've had to look at all areas of my life. I used to have debt when I was young, and I don't have debt anymore. I've had to look at buying stuff that I don't need. I've had to look at sexual temptation. You had mentioned Diane. I have a similar past to you when I was young, and the choices of men. And even today, you know, I mean, I did a Snapchat, because I just like doing those. They're so silly. And I did a Snapchat, and I said that today I had found toilet paper and paper towels at Walmart, and I was so excited. And I said, you know, it's kind of a sad when they get you excited today, right? And I said, but in relationships, as a single, it doesn't take a lot to pull you away from God. And the longer you go without fellowship, the longer you go without a man or someone to tell you look pretty or smell nice, and that's a desire that you have. If you don't have it as a desire, then it's not an issue. But when you desire it and a man gives you a compliment or he looks at you in a certain way, you know, when you get a wink, you know, now I'm okay. I don't deal with the emails where the guy says, oh, you're so beautiful. I am from this country. I want to steal all your money. Those emails I'm good with. I don't respond to them. But I remember one time years ago, I was at a dance and there was a guy that I was talking to, and all of a sudden, I felt his knee touch my knee under the table. And I was like, and I was like kind of excited, right? You know, and it's been a long time when all it takes is a knee rub to get you excited, right? Because like Diane, you know, back in them old days, it took a whole lot more than a knee rub. You know what I'm saying, girl? Yeah, uh-huh. But now, you know, you're closer to God. The closer you are to God, the quicker you are sensitive to the things that are not of God. Okay? And the reason why you're numb at some of the things you fall into is because you're not close enough to perfection. Because the closer you are to God, you're like this when the enemy tempts you. As soon as he throws something at you, bam, you got it. Bam, you got it. And so that guy had giving me a little knee rub, and I was giving him a knee rub, he's giving me a knee rub, and all them little feelings in your belly all squishing around, and you getting all excited, you're like, woo, dear Lord, amen. And you're just like, wow. Well, long story short, we would end up dating or whatever, and one day I was talking to him, and I said, David, the first night I met you, you were flirting with me, instead of playing footsies, you were playing kneesies. And he's like, huh? And I said, don't you remember the first night you met me? I'm like, I rub my knee against yours. You rub my knee against yours. And I said, it was so sweet. He goes, huh? And he said, baby, I had a knee cast on that the first night that I met you. I didn't feel nothing. Yeah, that's funny, isn't it? But in all truth, you know, going back to John 10:10, the enemy comes to steal my joy. He wants to steal my confidence in God. But God's got us, guys. During this COVID, he's got us. Understand, he wants everyone to come to him. And the way the world was, they weren't coming to him. And we weren't doing our part in reaching people for him. So he's allowed this to happen. He's allowed it to happen. And he doesn't want you to miss out. He doesn't want you to miss this season. He wants you to reach people that you would normally never reach. Call people you'd never call. Help people you'd never call. He wants you to do things differently than the way you did them before, because this world is going away. It is going to hell. It is getting worse and worse and worse. And he's trying to wake people up. So as Christians, we have to be the model. We have to be the example. We have to be the light. And so we cannot allow the enemy to pull us into those things, those places that continue to be strongholds, those places that are continuing to try to kill you. You have to get stronger so that you can do more of the Lord's work and what he has you to do. And if in the process love comes, you know, amen. But like Paul, you know what? If it doesn't, amen. You know, I'm good either way, because I just want to be obedient. I just want to do what God wants me to do. The enemy comes to steal, he comes to kill, and he comes to destroy. And he wants to destroy that you're ever here and the witness that you've had to anyone. He wants to destroy anything you've ever said to anyone. But Christ came to give life and to give it abundantly. And understand, life, as like Gina was saying, temptation is up and down. If I said, oh, poor Gina, she does not have an abundant life, that'd be like Gina lives at home with 14 cats and never leaves. That's somebody who doesn't live an abundant life. But a person who lives an abundant life, their ups and downs, good and bad, emotions, sadness, joy, it's all of those things. Because he came to be that bridge. He felt all those things to help relate to us. But he came to give life more abundantly so that we would understand our value and understand why he came. And he wants others to know the same. So the next time you find yourself going, I really struggle with this thing, and this thing has caused separation between me and God. This thing is causing problems in my family. This thing is creating a whispering of the enemy into my brain and telling me that I look in the mirror and I'm tempted to say I'm ugly or I don't look good. I'm like, hey, girls, the Barbie years have been long gone for me, okay? I'm Barbie the after years. I'm the plus Barbie. I'm waiting for them to make a plus Barbie, okay? And you know what? You just got to celebrate where you are and know, you know what? God says I'm beautiful. I'm beautiful in what he sees. It's what the enemy tries to tell you what he sees and what his goal is. So celebrate your victories, just like Mandy said. When you find yourself, hey, you go to a friend's house, hey, you want some, you know, chocolate pudding or ice cream, like, oh, that is so nice of you. I'm good today. And you celebrate it. Don't worry about tomorrow. Just celebrate today. You're at Walmart and you leave with nothing but maybe some toilet paper. Celebrate and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for giving me the strength to bind the things that are of the enemy and to embrace the things that are of you. Can I pray with you? And you can keep going, okay? Dear Heavenly Father, we just praise you. We thank you. We honor you. We love you. We thank you for teaching us about temptation. This poor woman, just like, it's not just women, there's men, there's all of us, that we can get pulled down a wrong path. We know, Lord, temptation is not the bowl of chocolate. Temptation is the look of chocolate. It's the smell of chocolate. It's the seeing of the chocolate. It's our senses that pull us into this temptation. But your word says the wisdom, the knowledge, our brain is what keeps us from following through. So Lord, I pray I pray for each lady here, whatever it is, that they would lay it at your feet and they would ask those to help them, that maybe if there's friends in their life that said, listen, would you hold me accountable? Would you check in me every week? Ask me how I'm doing with watching too much TV, or how am I doing with being on my phone too much, or how am I doing with saying negative thoughts or gossiping or being discouraging? But Lord, the opposite of accountability, Lord, have every lady also be accountable to what they're doing in you. What are they changing in their life? Who are they talking to each week? Who are they sharing their life with? Who are they witnessing to? And Lord, be with each one of them during this season. Protect them from this disease. Keep us all healthy, Lord, and help us to be grow more and more like you. Thank you for Gina. Thank you for her heart and her love for you. In Christ's name, yes, amen. God.